This is Papa Smurf. You're listening to Our Lifestyle, the podcast with ODB and the Mayor.
Our Lifestyle, the podcast, brought to you by Sparkles Detail. Visit sparklesdetail.com in order today, or have the clean team that supports the scene detail your ride at any event that they're in attendance. Also, Custom Car Show Productions. That includes Orange Beach Invasion, Scraping the Coast, Bayou Showdown, and Sicknick. Make sure you follow Orange Beach Invasion, Scraping the Coast, and Bayou Showdown on Instagram. These events also can be found on Facebook with much more details. Make sure you tell them Our Lifestyle, the podcast, sent you.
Hey, Em, you know you're my favorite white boy, right? I owe you for this one.
I've been patiently waiting for a track to explode on. Yeah. You stun if you won't, and your ass will get rolled on. It feels like my flow's been hot for so long. Yeah. You thinking I'ma fucking fall off? You're so wrong.
I'm menacing in my head, like a baby bone dead. Destination heaven. Sitting politic with passengers from 9/11. Yeah. The Lord's blessings leave me lyrically inclined. Shit, I ain't even got to try to.
Yo. It's Our Lifestyle, the podcast, coming at you. Episode 110. We got Biggity Mike, the mayor, in the house. He's playing the heel this go round. What's going down, my man?
ODB!
And Airhead Nation, what it is, what it ain't. It's another beautiful day down here in Southwest Florida. So good to be back with you and the Airhead Nation. Missed you guys last week, but I'm back.
Hey, Mike, I got a question, serious question. Where were you February 5th, 1988, my man?
Well, let me tell you something, brother. I was watching the Hulkster and Andre the Giant in that fixed match because there's no way
Andre the Giant was going to ever take down the Hulkamania and all his Hulkamaniacs because they all go wild, baby. Woo! Oh, wait, that was Ric Flair. But anyway, I actually remember actually watching that. When you mentioned that to me earlier, I know I watched that fight, or I say fight, that fixed arrangement. And, of course, Ted DiBiase supposedly paid, you know, everybody off to where Andre the Giant would win that match. And, of course, he did. But I believe that wasn't WrestleMania. And then that same year, they wrestled at WrestleMania, and the Hulkster actually body slammed Andre the Giant and pinned Andre the Giant to win back the WWF title, because at that time they were still WWF.
Before the worldwide life, whatever fund or whatever it was, sued them, right?
The worldwide, what was it? The something to do with animals.
Yeah, some WWF, man. They came through and stole the show, but dude,
oh,
man.
It's the World Wildlife Federation is
yeah,
what it was.
Yeah, there you go. You know, it was crazy, too. I think everybody's going to laugh. The joke was on me for years. I thought Big Show was really Andre's son. Dude, man, I had a lot to learn about some wrestling, huh, Mike?
Come on, see, you needed to quit watching that damn rad and started paying attention to some wrestling, and you would have known better, son.
Coming off the upper ropes with a backflip to people's elbow or something, I don't know.
Could you imagine Andre the Giant doing a damn jumping off the top rope and actually landing on somebody? Oh my God.
The only Andre the Giant I know was in the movie Princess Bride.
And yes, he was. He was in the Princess Bride.
Airhead Nation, this episode is brought to you by Orange Beach Invasion. You know that is a custom car show productions. It's going down. You heard it at the top of the show. And that is Orange Beach, Alabama. Where else would you rather be, Miggity Mike? Spring Break Weekend. That's March 15th to the 17th. It's going down.
It's going down for real, baby. And hey, guys, I had somebody ask the other day how much it costs to be a spectator. It's free. It is absolutely free. So make sure you guys are at Orange Beach Invasion, March 15th through the 17th, The Wharf, Orange Beach, Alabama. You don't want to miss out.
It's going down for real. Da-na-na-na-na. Okay, I got no flow. So Mike, we had an awesome episode 109. Who was our guest again?
Mrs. Karen Moore.
Dude, she's on point. You got a chance to meet her last year at Forbidden Fantasy. Dude, that laugh, those epic stories. We did the math earlier, Mike. She's been doing this a lot longer than I have, a lot longer than a lot of the old school mini truckers out there. And she looks damn young too, man. So 30 plus years, man. If we can't maybe nudge some of the guys on the committee to say, hey, her name needs to be at least in the talks for the Mini Truck Hall of Fame, dude. She's been laying it down for years, my man.
Dude, you are not lying. And not only that, but she gave us her age. I'm not going to repeat it because you got to go back and listen. But I had no idea that she was, I'm not going to say that old, but I didn't realize that she was that young. I was like, well, I guess that doesn't sound any better. But anyway, she definitely looks good for her age. And she has got stories for days and some damn good stories. And props to her because, man, when she put the text out, she put the she sent the Batman flare out, bat sign, whatever you want to call it. Hey, getting ready to go to Rezzo. Nobody answered back. She's like, fuck y'all, I'm going anyway. Jumped in the damn truck and she drove and drove and drove all by her damn self. So props to you, Karen. And yes, I did get to meet her out at Forbidden Fantasy, which I won't be able to go to this year, but no fear because ODB will be there. So make sure you guys check out ODB over there at Forbidden Fantasy.
It's gonna be real deal, man. Straight West Coastin', you know how we do. Definitely, Mike, also gonna try to recap the last episode with a couple quick things. We talked about the pre-order continues. We ODB myself, I talked about the Grand National Roadster Show, some of the things that went down there, including their Instagram account. Obviously, talked about that Hammered Weekend Wear, their pre-order concluding. They had the epic Isuzu truck, Chris Rollins. Oh, yeah, we talked a little bit about Relaxed Miller, so we got a shout-out for him on this episode as well. And then we kind of rounded it out with mentioning that Showtime did pick up that four-part documentary series on the Wu-Tang Clan, the Of Mics and Men. That's going to be coming out around springtime. So, Mike, with that being said, you know, Dr. Dre and Snoop said, you know, to the next episode, but we're kind of going to the last episode, and that was the recap. Anything else you got to add before we move on, my man?
Hey, you brought up our boy, Ron, with Hammered Weekend Wear, and I just seen you guys' trailer ready, and he's getting ready to make the trek to over to LST. So everybody that's heading to LST, have a safe trip. We all know it's probably one of the biggest shows, if not the biggest show, in our scene going right now. And I know a whole bunch of people are going. So everybody enjoy and have a damn good time. And make sure y'all post lots of pictures. And let's pray that this year we don't have to worry about taking out the canoes and watch Ronnie from C10 Talk go across the show field in his canoe. So let's hopefully we can keep the canoes on top of the trucks and enjoy the show. So, Ron, be safe on your trek across America to good old LST and sell a whole bunch of Hammered Weekend Wear shit.
Hails to the yeah. That's Hammered, H-A-M-M-E-R-D, weekendwear.com. So, Mike, pre-order continues. We got a little bit of news, though. A lot of people, you know, push out deadlines. You know, we try to stay on point. All Time Low magazine, these guys are the king of deadlines. They put out deadlines. They get their work submitted. That way they can get printed and shipped to the Airhead Nation and all of their awesome followers out there. But, Mike, you and I spoke a little bit earlier, and we said, you know what? We got to take it to the next level. Tell the Airhead Nation what we're going to do with our shirts that are still in pre-order.
Okay, our pre-order for our shirts for the new Minis on the Rise Volume Deuce was going to end on Monday, February 18th. But we are actually going to stop the pre-order a little early and end it February 10th. So Sunday, February 10th, the pre-order will end. And this is what we have in mind. If we have it, if we end it February 10th, we will be able to have them done and ready. So when I see all you Airhead Nation peeps at OBI, I can just give you your shirts there at OBI. So,
and we'll have some to slang.
And I'll have some to slang. But so if you didn't get your pre-order in, remember, if you guys want talls, make sure you do the pre-order. Okay. If you need the big sizes, make sure you pre-order, because the bigs and the talls, we're not going to be printing no extra ones of any, you know, of those. So make sure you get that pre-order in. And Jay, where do they go to put the order in for Minis on the Rise Volume 2 shirt?
Hey, we're all about working smarter, not harder. If you've got us saved, if in your browser, Safari or Chrome browser, you just go to ourlifestylepodcast.bigcartel.com. It's even easier if you just go to Instagram, tap on the link in our bio. It's going to open into Instagram. Oftentimes, if you want to bookmark that, just hit the little up arrow and open it in your Chrome browser or Safari. Save it as a favorite. Boom, make it easy. But if you tap the link in our browser, in our bio, you'll be able to hit the main website. You'll be taken. You'll see the five different colors listed there. The teal, white, raspberry, black, and then charcoal. Get your pick. Make sure the order's in. And if you're listening to this on Friday, you'll basically have the rest of Friday, Saturday, and then Sunday, right, Mike, until midnight. And, boom, then we're going to take them down as no longer for sale, because we can't allow for other orders to trickle in, because we're going to submit the order to Graphic Disorder. Now, sure, we are going to order some extra, as Mike said, but we have to kind of cut it off, so to speak. Once we get those in hand, then they'll be updated for any that we have left over.
Yes, sir. And with that being said, Jay will be at After Dark February 16th. After Dark February 16th, the mayor's first show. Yes, you heard it first. First show. So, guys, make sure you hit up ODB at After Dark. He's going to have Minis on the Rise Volume 1 shirts. We also got a little something that I don't know if some of you guys have seen it yet, but we have our new license plates. RJ over at iCandy Designs is got the new laser going on over there. So we printed out, we had some license plates made up, and Jason will have them with him at After Dark. So those will go up on the website after the show. So if you guys are there at After Dark, pick them up there at After Dark. If not, they will be on the site after the show.
Yeah, and come by just to slap hands. Let's talk a little bit. Make sure you guys are, of course, following us. Maybe we'll do something if we have a few little giveaways for anyone that shows that they are subscribed to the podcast. We'll try to work something out. We've got the new booth, as Mike mentioned. The homie Biggity Boss Bolin will be in the house. Hopefully we'll bring out, we will bring a few bikes. We're not going to get too crazy, but we'll bring a couple classics out for everyone to enjoy. We'll have the donk boards out there. We'll have All Time Low magazine. We will also have, of course, some of the His Hammered Weekend Wear, any kind of small giveaways that we have. So looking forward to it, Mike. We know the location, easy in, easy out, and it's going to be a damn good time. It's great when there's another show in the scene, especially locally, that we can go out and enjoy.
Oh, you ain't lying, brother. And definitely looking forward to seeing everybody. And make sure we also still have the keychains, and Jay will have those on hand. And so just hit up Jay, check him out over at the booth, and get it taken care of.
My man. So also wanted to say, on episode 109, I did mention Joshua Miller's, a.k.a. Josh Miller, his badass rendering. Mike, there was a cool little shout-out, and I couldn't remember the homie's name. I knew it was in your notes. Why don't you let the Airhead Nation, talk a little bit about the fist bump that we saw there on Facebook, man.
No, Kenneth Morris gave our boy Mr. Miller, the credit where credit is due, and reshared it. And it's going to be a badass truck. It was a badass truck before, Now we're going to add two more doors to it. So it's going to be for sure badass. Let's just hope that this rendering is just a joke and it's really going to come out red. I really want to see this thing red.
Well, the word on the street is Miller told us not to share, but what he's trying to do, Mike, is he's going to try to swerve everyone, right? So he's got the rendering in one color, thinking that he's going to bait everyone to go, you know what, I'm doing my truck in this color. But at the last second, dude, almost kind of like, what were the bobsledder guys' names? I forget the movie. It came out around the time White Men Can't Jump came out, which I'm one of those guys, by the way, that can't jump. they're going to come in at the last second, dude, and it's almost
the Jamaican bobsledding team?
Yeah. The movie, though. I can't remember the name.
Cool Runnings.
There you go. And at the last second, they're almost going to do, like, there's going to be a rap on it. And it's going to be the craziest unveiling ever. It's going to have a drone and everything. And then they're going to grab the wrap and they're going to rip it off. And it's really going to be red. I don't know. You think it's going to happen?
Hey, we can only wait and find out. But with that being said, Mr. Miller will have his truck at After Dark. So you can talk up with Mr. Josh Miller there at After Dark. And also, Mr. Miller, Greg Miller, will be at After Dark. And with that being said, he will be giving away two Scraping the Coast registrations, two free Scraping the Coast registrations at After Dark for Scraping the Coast. So definitely be on the lookout for that.
You know it, my man. It's going to be damn good time. I cannot wait. I'd love to be at the unveiling of Miller's truck. Dude, love the color. Sick-ass rendering. Nick at Surface Art. You know, he's on top of his game. Interior looks cool from what we can see. Definitely looking forward to it. With Josh and the whole RA crew, they stay, Mike. On to what?
Rise.
Never fall. Never fail. You know it. So another homie. Well, we kind of just were talking about the big homie, Greg Miller. But check this out, Mike. The new artwork dropped, and I know you know full well how Fuel Market does it.
Dude, Fuel Market does it right. And shout out to Tim Davis, because that's his 95 Nissan Hardbody on the OBI. And this is the limited edition shirt, too. So there's other shirts, but this is the limited edition one. I do apologize. I don't know whose lifted truck that is. It's a badass lifted truck, but I'm not sure what the guy's name is. But congratulations to him as well. But definitely always good to see minis on show shirts. And Tim Davis's 95 Nissan Hardbody definitely does not disappoint.
It does not. And Mike, if I remember correctly, keep me honest here, All Time Low Magazine issue 16, lower right corner of that cover features the same truck. Then you flip to pages 14 and 15. You've got that truck. It's an RA truck. We talked about it. You go to the next two pages, and you've got a sick-ass layout there. So, and then you can't forget the Brothers in Skating that was on pages 8 and 9, I believe it was. So, I mean, that truck is making its rounds, and it does prove that minis stay on the rise.
Yes, sir. Ain't no stopping them, baby.
Ain't nobody does it better or something like that. So speaking of magazines, I will do a full flip through. I did a partial flip through of All Time Low Magazine. Gonna bake that audio into this. Think of an audio book by ODB of said magazine without reading every single word. So it's gonna be awesome, Mike. We gotta keep doing it. Hopefully you guys like it. And it's going to get you guys to want to really dive into this magazine because it is that good. Quality's on point. We've seen other regional, what I call regional type magazines that just don't hit the mark, or maybe over the course of time they kind of fizzle out a little bit. These guys, the fire is fully lit and they're keeping it going. For anybody that's watched the Netflix series on the Fire Festival, this is definitely not the Fire Festival. This is true fire, All Time Low Magazine. You know how they do.
Dude, always on point. And like you said, consistency is key. And I do believe we got word that next magazine, which is going to be issue 17, is heading off to the printers really soon, guys. So be on the lookout. If you haven't subscribed to All Time Low magazine yet, make sure you get that subscription in because issue 17 is coming out real soon.
ATLmagazine.com. You guys know how they do. So speaking of magazines, Mike, I did touch upon this last episode, the Street Trucks March 2019. There is a little bit of a hidden, we'll call it error, mistake on the cover, and they did not shy away from this. Chris Hamilton actually posted, I think it was on his personal Instagram, his story, he mentioned, some of you guys will see it right away, others will treat it like the Playboy magazine with the hidden bunny somewhere that you gotta find, but there is a little bit of an artistic error on the cover, so let's see if you guys pick up on that. Mike, the magazine is fantastic. Another awesome issue. I would tell anybody, make sure you subscribe from the beginning with the new products all the way through some of the new refreshed ads. It's definitely on point. You got text by Travis Nowak with SS02, so Square Body Syndicate. That's the cover truck. Insane blown LS3 motor that was built and dyno-tuned by Pro Dyno. Super, super sick layout. It even has one of my favorite features of a truck feature, whether it's a cover or not. They had a under construction build there where you had just the chassis, no bed on it, and then, of course, the cab is there. So a super awesome layout for the cover. You also have Rad Roadster. Now, this was by Grant Cox and written by Mike Self, so a really kick-ass K5. A little bit different of style, so it's cool to see something different. And Street Trucks is not afraid to go out of their normal, you know, bounds, if you will, to feature a cool truck like that. They had the 41st annual F100 Super Nationals, so the F100s and so on and so forth, they stay on the rise. Very cool ads. You also have All Locked Up, and it talks about bed security, Watanos, toppers. Of course, you know, we love Topper Gang. Awesome toolboxes. You got Beltec, AccuWare with some pretty cool ads here, different billet companies. And then I hinted at the last episode, Fireshot. So this was a 62C10, Mike. John Mata wrote it. Brian Good shot it. Dude, all red. You got some billets that are tucking like crazy. So badass feature. Salute to Brian from Grindr TV. Okay, you got Dino's Get Down. You guys know all well about that. Pretty cool to see the coverage continue to grow over time. Lots of pages there from dualies, C10s, squares, you know it. Midnight Oil. So another little bit different of a truck. You've got an insane billet wheel on this Ford Lightning F-150. Words by the editor, Chris Hamilton. Photos by Victor Lopez. Don't see these too often, Mike, so it's pretty cool to see a Lightning. And oh, by the way, I believe it is Static Drop. You got October Madness. So representing Houston's love for music and sport trucks. Again, different type of event that they're featuring with a lot of badass rides. You got a pretty cool tech article. You round it out with a few more ads. 2019 Ford Ranger review. When I see this truck, I don't think Ranger, but it has a full range of what it can do. A few more ads, of course, to pay the bills, and then the event scene. So, Mike, what stands out here is we kind of mentioned how they bake in the artwork. You've got Orange Beach Invasion, Forbidden Fantasy, laid out at the park, Mini Truck Nationals, so on and so forth with the different shows. They do have Scraping the Coast listed as well, so they're already forward thinking. So when I lay this issue down, Mike, I say, damn, another great issue from cover to back cover. You got to subscribe to Street Trucks.
Dude, you are not lying. And I tell you what, we just got done highlighting a magazine. You know, we didn't even talk about this, Jay, but just scrolling, sitting here looking through the computer as you're reading that off and going through that stuff, a page on Facebook that I'd like to give a shout out to is Tilt Bed Evolution. If you guys have not seen this page, checked out this page, or seen any of these posts that they pop up, I mean, I don't know how many guys are working this page, But they constantly are working it and posting up pitcher after pitcher after pitcher. I know the guy that's in charge of it is Jeremy French. And the other reason why I bring this up, because Jeremy is bringing back the whole tilt bed, the dancing beds, which I used to go to Nopi back in the day, and that was the whole – I loved going there and watching the beds dance, the dancing beds and the hydraulic competitions and so on and so forth. Well, Jeremy is going to be bringing Tilt Bed Revolution to Scraping the Coast this year, and it's going to be – they're going to be putting on a big show. But definitely check out Tilt Bed Evolution on Facebook. Just go in the search bar, type in T-I-L-T – Bed, B-E-D, Evolution, E-V-O-L-U-T-I-O-N, and check out that page. Hit the like, follow, whatever button you want to push, and just pay attention, man, because he's got some cool-ass shit on this page.
Yeah, check that hashtag, Tilt Beds on the Rise. It does not stop. Mini Trucking's coming for a full takeover. That's a little nod out there to the homie running the Mini Trucking Takeover. Instagram, dude, stays on point. He's got the pedal stomp to the ground. Shout out to him. So, Mike, did you see the other famous Jimmy's Rod and Customs bagged and laid out white truck from Florida? That is for what? For sale. Did you happen to see what the deal is?
No, I missed that one. Which one are we referring to?
Uh-oh, so guess what? Big Juice is on the loose, and we're not talking about OJ, brother. Dude, so you guys know original U, like the letter U, ain't, and then L-O, so original U ain't low, or U, Y-O-U, ain't low trucks, all spelled out there. Check it out, dude. He just got featured for street trucks, and the Ram is up for sale. So check it out. I'm super stoked, man. This guy builds very cool stuff. He drives his stuff. If I remember correctly, he doesn't even technically have a garage. It just goes to show you, you can have a badass truck and enjoy it, drive it everywhere, whether it's new school, old school. Man, I don't know anybody else that's been doing it as long as he has with the consistency. He gave us a huge shout out recently, so I want to thank him. He posted just a few days ago, he says, street trucks photo shoot today. I can't thank everyone enough who helped. Of course, at Jimmy's Rod and Customs is listed first. And he's got that hashtag. Super badass guy. Want to say the truck is about 40K. Totally worth it with the amount of work that's into it. He's, of course, repping that Topper gang. And Mike, I'm going to hate to see it go, but just imagine what he's going to build next, man.
Dude, I'm more than pretty sure he's already got something else in mind. And I'm sure he's already got that reserve, that down payment, waiting in line over there with Jimmy. And just can't wait to see what else comes out there because he's had nothing but badass vehicles. And, of course, Jimmy's built every one of them.
You know it. And you know what's a little odd, but at the same time kind of cool, I also noticed – that Enfuse, that's underscore N-U-F-S-E-D, I think I'm saying the name right, the homie has his old Chevy that has been wrapped into like the blue color. You can't even really tell from the photos that it's a wrap, but he is also selling that truck. That's also what Jimmy built when Big John drove it to SEMA and back. Same wheels, I believe, are still on it. Truck looks fantastic. This is the homie's daily driver. Dude, I don't know what to say, but, I mean, it is sick. That truck is also up for sale. It still has the red seats, so the nice red guts on it, and the blue wrap still looks insane. I bet if you peel the wrap off, the original black paint is underneath, it's going to look great. So two awesome Florida-built trucks for sale that still are currently in Florida. If you guys are looking, check it out. They're not cheap, but they're damn good, and you're going to get a lot for what you pay for.
Well, and like you said, if it's Jimmy built, then you know you got yourself a good truck.
You know it, man. So the next thing I got, Mike, is a couple updates, and then I'll see if you want to share anything. We tend to hit on some of our own projects. I'm working on 64 Lincoln, Smuggler's Blues. You guys have seen the hashtag. If you follow my at Lincoln Addict, you guys know all about it. I'm super stoked. Pretty soon I'll have some CC Cycle wheels for this thing. love their product. I always like to say, making America choose billet again. They have their own little saying, of course, that's official. That's my unofficial ODB little saying. But Colorado Custom Wheels, man, these guys have been doing it a long time. If you recall and you've been a listener for a while, you know that we had Michael on to talk about the history, the rich history of an awesome company. I am stoked that I will have a set of these wheels probably in the next couple months. I haven't officially ordered them, but I will be soon. Also, just got a package in from Steel Rubber. If you have a classic car, or a vehicle that you need weather stripping for, visit Steel Rubber. That's S-T-E-E-L-E, rubber.com. You also should follow them on Instagram. Basically, the whole box is a lot of different pieces that I need. These Lincolns, as you know, Mike, they have tons of, I guess you could say it, rubber that you need for it. And it goes from everywhere to the door seals, around the convertible, around the windshield, you name it. When you order a catalog from their website, which is free, they will send you an individual catalog for your specific vehicle that you select. You've seen them possibly if you watch My Classic Car. It's a great company. I love to promote great quality companies. So check it out. Follow My Lincoln Addict. I will be sharing a lot of videos on installations and just the quality overall. Devious Customs, I'm looking to basically use the entire kit and have the professionals over at Jimmy's Rod and Customs lay out the 64 Lincoln. Now, Mike, don't laugh. This might be a first for ODB. The goal is to drive the car into Jimmy's shop. Imagine that. I'll have something that's driving. And when Jimmy says, hey, come pick it up, homie, I'll be like, all right, I get to drive it out of the shop and onto the trailer, man. Imagine that. So I'm super stoked about the vehicle. Jimmy and the team over there, they are second to none, like DJ Quick said, and I'm super stoked. It's all going to start coming together here in the next few months. Maybe a little bit slower than I had hoped, but I think that's always the deal, Mike. So I am stoked. I know you were over at Gulf Coast Customs the other day. Were you guys just out there smoking, or were you guys actually working?
Well, if you ask Mrs. Mayor, she'll tell you that only thing that goes on Thursdays is beer drinking Thursdays, because my truck is still not done yet, the Tahoe. And so she accuses us of doing nothing but drinking beer. But I can tell you that we did not work on the Tahoe, but there is another vehicle in there that Keith over at Gulf Coast Customs is working on, and it's Leo Barr's 2018 Silverado that's getting bagged right now, and he's hoping to have it all done and ready for After Dark. So that's pretty much what Keith's concentrating on and working on right now. So hopefully we'll be done. I think he's going to be done with it by this Friday.
Great, man. Well, I love going and checking out what he's got going on Instagram at Gulf Coast Customs altogether. Dude is very talented, man. And I love seeing what he does. And there's not a lot of shops way down there in Southwest Florida. Man, you guys are like the last exit before what, like Miami or something? I don't know.
Exit 101, baby.
Cuba?
Basically.
You got to be swimming over there. So that's what we got going down. I'm super stoked about Project Smuggler's Blues. You guys know the Glenn Fry classic. My dad, Papa Smurf, rest in peace. We love that track. When the Lincoln came and it was blue, our favorite color, I said, biggity boom, we're going to lay it down. And then as we recently gave Jake over at Rendered by Thor, we gave him a huge shout out. Love to see the guys hustle. If you think you've seen some pretty cool renderings that are hand-drawn, think again. There's a lot of talented artists out there, but when you look up Rendered by Thor, whether it's a mini, a classic, an old-school truck, dude does not disappoint. He even recently did a patina-style C10 that's rusted in the front in different color greens and shades. I mean, dude, mind-blowing. So I just love bringing people together, Mike, seeing the different talent out there. And I'm super stoked for 2019. I'm going to keep the pedal stomped. But I would like for you, if you don't mind, hit on some upcoming shows, my man.
Well, of course, like we've been talking about, I'm going to go ahead and just concentrate on two for right now. And the first, of course, being mine, and that's After Dark. Okay, it's February 16th, Quaker Steak and Lube. And I want to give a big shout out to RJ Silva, printing out these banners, printing out these getting these trophies made. And of course, the dash plaques and all the stuff that he helps me with, you know, trying to make this show possible. And of course, Lowrider Depot, we just got the stuff in from Lowrider Depot, got tons of giveaways, guys. So of course, ViAir, Lowrider Depot. I got a bunch of different artists that are putting some decks together and skate decks, painting them up. And we're going to be doing giveaways with those guys. We got some metal work that's being done for, you know, for giveaways. Graphic Mafia printing out a bunch of After Dark shirts. And so we got a bunch of stuff that we're going to be giving away. Remember, it's top 25 with a bunch of best ofs. I can't forget Feltham Fab, Jason Feltham, with the cornhole boards. And if you play cornhole, those boards are badass. So one team's going to be walking away with those two badass After Dark cornhole boards. And, dude, it's going to start. Roll in's at 4. It's going to end at 10. Trophies will start at 9. You know, actually, the giveaways start at 9, and then we'll roll right into the trophies afterwards. So definitely be there. It's $20. Clubs roll in together. They park together. You know that whole. You know how that works. Vendors setup's gonna be at 3, so we might start the roll in earlier. Just depends on if our vendors get there and get set up. The sooner we can get our vendors set up, the sooner we can let you guys start rolling in, and you guys can go in there and enjoy some of those drinks. And that good food there at Quaker Steak and Lube. If you guys got any questions, hit me up. I can answer all of them. Last thing, Billy the Kid is getting this damn Dragon the Wagon club participation trophy. He's getting that ready. So he popped up some pictures the other day. He's got that bitch laid out. It's definitely Dragon. And now he's just got to get it painted up. So look forward to seeing the pictures from that. And thank you, Billy the Kid, for making that happen. And, of course, make sure you stop by and see all of our vendors that are going to be set up there. Like I said before, OLP will be set up there. Jason with the new setup. Sparkles Detail, Stingray Chevrolet, Enhanced Customs. Frank with Enhanced Customs. Of course, we got FX Customs. We got Feltham Fab. We got the other one that I wanted to give a special shout out to is Jesse and Anna. They're going to be set up out there. And if you guys don't know Jesse Perez, he's got the clown truck. Okay. He's got a bunch of clowns all over his truck. And just it's badass the way that they laid this thing out. And but he needs a kidney. So they're going to be set up there. And Anna makes these baskets and flowers, and she's going to be selling all this stuff. And all the money that she raises from this is going to go help Jesse with this transplant and, you know, before and after. And, you know, he's missing a lot of work, and obviously he's going to miss a lot of work after the transplant. So, and if you would like to find out and see if you're a match and you'd like to donate a kidney to help Jesse, you know, definitely check that out and look them up on Facebook, and or if you see them there at the show, you know, stop by, give them some encouragement, and if you'd like to help them out, talk to them there at the show. So, and then of course we got OBI March 15th and the 17th. It's at the Wharf, Orange Beach, Alabama, and like I said earlier, it's free to spectators, guys. So you there's no reason why you can't be there. Registration is going on now. I believe it ends March 3rd. And so the all the spots for the inside are all taken up, but there's plenty of other parking going on. And guys, there's plenty of restaurants there. You're right. All you got to do is you show up. You got the condos right there. You got the hotels right there. All the restaurants, all the shopping, the spa. They got a water park there. They got zip lines there. They got a movie theater there. Everything is right there, and it's a badass car show. So if you guys haven't made plans yet, make sure you guys hit up OBI March 15th through the 17th, spring break weekend. You don't want to miss it.
You definitely don't. And those corn boards look insane. You almost need one of those, like, Zag screen protectors for them because it looks so damn good. I wish I was talented, Mike. I can't do any of that kind of shit, but it's pretty badass.
You can't play cornhole or you can't make those boards?
I can't make those boards. Yeah, but, I mean, give me a couple brews, man. I usually shoot them like Kobe Bryant overhand, dude, swooshing them, dude, from the other side. People are like, how does this guy do it, man? And get a blindfold on like Sandra Bullock. Next thing you know, man, it's like just down another one, man. Now I'm not talking about beers.
Yeah, I know what you're talking about.
So we're going to round this one out. Dude, I joked about it earlier. If you have not seen one of the biggest debaucheries and you are in for, I want to say a good laugh. I mean, at the end of the day, you kind of feel bad for some of these people, but you really kind of go, how effing stupid can you be? When you've logged into Netflix, you've probably seen this pull up on your feed and you're like, I don't know, this some stupid shit. I finally watched it. The homie told me, dude, you got to see it. Fire Festival, or I think it might just be called Fire, F-Y-R-E. Dude, Mike, this guy thinks he's some big entrepreneur. He's got all these people giving him money. He's going to do some big music festival down in the Bahamas on a private island. They tell this guy, look, he supposedly buys Pablo Escobar's personal island for, I don't know, $8 million, something like that. So he puts a down payment. Well, they tell him the first thing, Mike, the first thing you can't do is you are not allowed to mention Pablo Escobar at all. The first video they put out, Pablo Escobar's island, come down here and party. They're going to do this festival, and they're going to have artists and Ja Rule, the idiot he is. He's on board. And, man, it just gets to the end, and it gets almost funnier and funnier because this guy is just, like, digging himself a grave, dude. Like, flying people down there. All these people get down there. There's nothing set up, dude. No logistics. I mean, think of your worst car show you ever went to ever in your life. This is, like, a million times worse. So, Fire Festival on Netflix. It is crazy. It's going to make you laugh a couple times, and it just shows the power of social media and, Mike, how stupid some people really are.
Especially when they tell you not to do it, and the first thing you do is do exactly what they told you not to do.
Exactly. It's like, what the fuck? So, Beastie Boys, I saw this earlier. You guys have heard me talk about at Beastie Boys book on Instagram. They mentioned a short time ago the book has been nominated for some sort of audiobook of the year award. I have not listened to the audiobook. I do have the book that I've yet to read because I'm slow reading at other books, but I will get to it. Hopefully soon we're going to have the homie Rich Arachi from Severn, Arizona in the coming weeks or months back on. He's a big Beastie Boys fan. He read it, loved to get his take on it. But Mike, that's kind of the culture in hip-hop updates that I have. I did want to ask you a little bit before we wind down here about a big game or something that happened last Sunday that was named after, and this is the truth, Super Bowl. That's what it was named after. No joke. Look it up. That's the history. What did you think about this game that was named after Super Bowl?
Well, I don't know about Super Bowl, but I know Super Bowl. And it was a fucking dud because I didn't win no goddamn money. And that was the worst fucking part. And all these damn Super Bowl square games that I'm in, we need scoring. Guys, you need to score. Change the damn score. And these two damn defenses played so damn good, or the Rams offense was just that damn bad, that there was no damn scoring, Jay. So it was pretty fucking boring. I mean, you had to really like football to like that game. And pretty much the Super Bowl party we were at, all the ladies were bored, so all they kept doing was talking. So I was just paying attention to the score changes, and there was none. So I didn't make no damn money. So it sucked in that aspect. So with that being said, did you really think the halftime show was as bad as everybody was saying it was?
Here's what I've learned. No matter, let's say you're sitting there with your friends and family and you got a drink or whatever you're doing, eating, and it's on, everybody's jumping around. It could be Michael Jordan, Michael Jackson, Mike Tyson. It doesn't matter who's there, right? It could be anybody. It could be the Beatles. It could be a hologram. It could be Tupac. It could be one of the most beloved people of all time. Fuck, it could be Mother Teresa. And, you know, you're playing along with it. You're like, yeah, it's kind of cool, whatever. It does not matter who does the Super Bowl. I have learned it will, or the Super Bowl halftime show, it will get buried no matter what. Now, was I the biggest fan of it? Well, I'm not a huge Maroon 5 fan. Think they've got some cool songs, talented dude. It got a little bit out of hand, you know, for some people. They're like, they hated it. I'm a huge Outkast, Big Boy fan. Would have loved Andre 3000 to come out as a surprise. Knew it wasn't going to happen, but I was like, I don't know that it was as horrible. I mean, you had the fireworks stuff going. You had the Maroon 5, which, again, I'm not all at looking at guys with their shirts off and tattoos. That's not my thing. But, like, on a scale, I don't know, what would you say? A scale of 1 to 10, 10 being, like, the best ever, 1 being, you know, put me out of my misery. What would you have given it as Miggity Mike the Mayor?
Well, the one thing I was a little disappointed on is they rolled, I believe it was Big Boy, rolled out in a Cadillac. Am I correct?
He did.
Could he have found a better damn Cadillac to roll out in than that one?
I was thinking that. So it was an old school Cadillac. They tweeted at him after the, and by the way, if you guys aren't following us on Twitter, our Lifestyle Pod, I was tweeting the whole game. I don't think anybody was watching, but I had a good time tweeting, and I didn't have any alcohol all week because I've been sick. So yeah, he comes out in the old Cadillac, and they tweeted him after, and they said, "I like the way you move," and he goes, "Thanks, send me a new truck." And they said, "Tell your people to call our people." But I thought that was a little odd because, yeah, the car wasn't, you know, like you see the wrestlers come out and these like real nice Harleys and whatnot, OCC type bikes. Then he kind of comes out in that. I was like, like, could they just not get the right car at the right time? I don't know, man.
I just think that there could have been a whole lot. There's so many badass Cadillacs out there, and he could have came out with one that looked a lot damn better than that Cadillac that he came out, he rolled out in. That's all I'm trying to say.
Christina Ceremi could have shipped hers over. I mean, hell, she probably would have did it for the right cost. You know what I mean? She would have had to be in it, though.
Much better than the Cadillac that he rolled in. That's for damn sure.
Well, and you can't forget this. And not, you know, we don't cover politics here. We don't, you know, talk about all that bullshit. But a lot of people did, a lot of artists boycott it for whether it's right or wrong, whatever. So you had artists that were like, hell no, we're not going to do the halftime show, whatever. So I was a little surprised, you know, Big Boy being a big part of the hip-hop community, classic hip-hop, Outkast, that he did it. But then my part was, like, his part was so short. You know, Sleepy Brown came out with him, which was cool that they're back together. They dropped a couple new songs, I think, the same day. So if you go on Spotify, you could check those out. Pretty good tracks. But, like, I don't know, man. It just, sometimes it kind of feels like it's, I mean, it's a great production, you know, all in all. I think it's a lot of work that they put together. But it's not something that I look back and in like 10 years, I'm going to be like, okay, there was Whitney Houston singing the national anthem. There was that one time Michael Jackson stood there for 2 minutes and didn't say anything, which, you know, whatever. Everyone remembers that. And then there was some guy without a shirt that had a whole bunch of tattoos on. Like, I'm just not going to remember this one. You know what I mean?
No, it definitely was not memorable. That's for damn sure. And that just goes back with that game, that it definitely was not memorable. But, hey, congratulations to the Patriots. They won. And I do believe, if I'm not mistaken, that Tom Brady's sixth championship. And that's pretty freaking awesome. Because I think that, if I'm not mistaken, that puts them up with the Steelers now, tied for the most Super Bowl wins.
Yep, forget one for the thumb. You need one for the other thumb. They used to say, like my dad, when you had four as a franchise, you go, you need one for the thumb. But that brings me to wind down that aspect of it. I mean, you guys aren't huge sports fans. You know, Kerry Iacino, he's listening. He's like, yeah, more sports. Our homie. The thing about it is, I think, you know, was it an old school game? Was it a defensive this and that? I mean, listen, man, the Rams, the quarterback, you know, Goff, I think his name is, you know, I felt a little bit bad for him, but it just goes to show you the preparation. The one guy that I was happy for that didn't win a Super Bowl was Sue. Obviously, you guys know the history, the sports fans, when he was in Detroit, the dirty shit that he did with the Packers multiple times. The guy's just a piece of shit. But whatever, you know, he's making more money than I am, and his life is great, right? So that's cool. But it just didn't have the – I would almost rather see a 28-3 comeback, right, a couple years ago. I mean, can't forget that, right? Maybe the greatest comeback in all time. So it is kind of weird how we kind of judge the Super Bowl and we go, ah, it sucked. But, like, if you're on the Patriots team, you're going, dude, this was awesome. We held them to 3 points. We played great. We didn't make too many mistakes. You know, at the beginning, the first drive, you see Brader throws a pick, and you're like, dude, this game, the whole momentum is going to change. Multiple times the Rams had an opportunity. They just did not capitalize, and it ended the way it ended. But Goff did do a much better job than your boy Cam Newton, pouting and shit after the game. So big ups. The Patriots, I'll say this, you're never going to see it again. I mean, you're never going to see a guy go to 9 Super Bowls and win 6. There's just no way.
I tell you what, it seems like every time we say something like that, you know, it happens. But I tell you, if anybody's going to do it, Mahomes, Kansas City Chiefs. The man is super young, and he has got a super, super bright future. But like you said, ain't nobody got no time to be listening to any damn sports on our Lifestyle the Podcast. So with that being said, I'm just glad the Saints weren't in the Super Bowl.
Who dat? Who dat? I know. We're going to get some slack from all the people in L.A. there, Louisiana. But, Mike, speaking about the game, if you had to narrow it down, I know this isn't easy, what was your favorite or most memorable commercial if you even watched those?
No, of course. Always pay attention to the commercials. And to me, I thought the best one was the Jason Bateman in the Hyundai commercial and the elevator where basically you're going, dropping people off at all the worst things like the, you know, the vet, the doctor, the dentist office, you know, so on and so forth. And then I thought that one was probably the best. And then Bud Light continues to kill it the way they just completely threw Coors Light. And what was it? Coors Light, Miller Light. They threw them under the bus with the whole corn syrup. I thought Bud Light killed it with the commercials as well. And the worst commercial had to be by far the freaking Burger King commercial. I didn't know who that guy was.
Andy Warhol.
Dude, when I first seen him at first, I had no idea who that was. And then somebody said it, and I'm like, oh, yeah, okay. But, dude, it was fucking retarded, okay? So my first question for you, because I actually paid attention here, Jay, why did he take his hamburger bun off, but then stick his ketchup on the side of the paper? Didn't even put his ketchup on his hamburger.
Well, the funny thing is, I did a little bit of research. I don't know that exact, you know, answer, but I didn't know you were going to actually bring that up, and it was obviously an old spot that had been recorded, and the family and I think the folks that are over his estate, they allowed for it to be used. And what I had read is after he had bitten into it and was eating the Whopper, he actually made a joke about why isn't this McDonald's or something like that. So I mean, it was very odd commercial. You know, Andy Warhol is looked at as someone that was kind of like a genius. But I don't know, man. You know, I look at it and say it was weird.
Extremely weird.
Yeah. So it says in an interview, this is something else I'm just looking up now. It says with the filmmaker below, he says Warhol initially suggested to use McDonald's. And yeah, so I don't know, man. Fast food is – the only fast food I eat is Chick-fil-A, so I'll throw that out there. I know some people hate Chick-fil-A now for political reasons, but, dude, you cannot beat one of them chicken sandwiches.
You are not lying because, dude, throw some damn honey mustard sauce and some extra pickle on that bad boy, and I'm good to go.
You know it. I would say for me, what stuck out was the one that had me kind of smiling, and I was like, ah, okay, wait, I see, wait, oh, who's that? Was the, believe it or not, as much as I sometimes cringe at some of the things the NFL does, they had a pretty cool commercial, yeah. The 100th anniversary.
Yes, NFL 100.
And what was cool, I thought, you know, they had a beast mode in there. So he played kind of an intricate role. You know, Mr. I'm just here, so I'm not going to get fined. You know, he sometimes has that bad boy type role that makes you kind of say, well, fuck this guy. But I think generally he is a good guy. You know, I've seen some pretty candid interviews. He's in it. You got Dion Primetime. You had Jim Brown. Dude, the Commissioner Goodell, like, it kind of, as much as I think he's, you know, whatever, but it was one that you're kind of like, you left, you're like, oh, yeah, that was cool. You know, they can still do some cool things here and there. Yeah, you know?
Well, hey, I ain't down on the NFL as bad as some of these other guys are, but I thought the commercial was awesome. I love the way they mixed a lot of the old with a lot of the new and a lot of the newer guys and the new hot stars. And I tell you what, though, Joe Montana is still the greatest of all time.
Yes. And didn't we see – we saw him in a commercial. Or yeah, he was in that one.
He
right?
was in there. Yeah, he was in there.
Yeah, and he also – I follow him on Instagram. He had posted a photo, and, of course, it sparked all kinds of – well, a couple things – there was one where he was like in a Chiefs jersey, I think. Or no, he was in a Chiefs game. And people were like going crazy, like, oh, fuck, I mean, you're a 49er. How could you do that? It's like, dude, God, he played for the Chiefs too, people. But he posted a photo, and it was kind of funny. He said, thinking about making a comeback for the NFL 100, be sure to watch the commercial, which was kind of cool. But, yeah, man, what a classy guy. He's always really beloved by fans. He's a good old school dude. I guess other commercials, you know, some I had tweeted out. If you go back and look at our Lifestyle Pod Twitter feed, you'll see a lot of the comments I made throughout the game. I thought Google had a pretty cool one. It was pretty moving. They usually have a nice nod to Martin Luther King Jr. So it was talking about the Translate app and how connected the world is. So I thought that was kind of cool. But overall, I don't think there was like a GoDaddy. A lot of the companies went a little conservative, you know, not to ruffle too many feathers, obviously, in this heightened political environment the whole world lives in. So it is what it is. Yeah. So we'll have to wait till next year, Mike.
Well, hey, with that being said, you sit here, keep talking about political. Our president's on TV right now, by the way.
Yeah. And is he which club is he a president of? I mean, is he...
Mini Trucker Association.
Yeah. Okay, so shout outs. So it's undergroundstyles.us. Big ups to the homie Mitch. Sent me some stickers. We're doing some cool things. He tags us daily in posts. Check out undergroundstyles.us. He just saw Dave Schulman's crew cut at a local show. Yes, he's one of my foot soldiers. This was a classy car show, and of course Dave rolls up in the crew cab dually on the hydraulics and he kills it. So big ups. Also, Banks 34 Mazdog DAWG on Instagram, killing it, tagging us in all kinds of old school throwback photos. One was David Caldwell's famous blazer, and it was rocking Colorado Custom Wheels. Sent that over to Michael, and no doubt Michael CC Cycle Wheels will more than likely reshare that. He loves those old school photos. So Mike, I'm going to round it down. ATLmagazine.com. You guys already know. Hammered Weekend Wear. Order some gear today, and don't forget to check out what's on sale. There's plenty of other product there outside of t-shirts. Hammered Weekend Wear. .com. That's HAMMERD. Great gift ideas for your homie's birthday. Custom Car Show Productions. Big ups, Orange Beach Invasion. Miggity Mike, the mayor, will be there in the house. You already know, March 15th to the 17th. SparklesDetail.com. Support the clean team that supports the team. Support the clean team that supports the scene. Tim and Tanya and the whole entire crew will lace your vehicle up at one of these shows with Croft Gate products. And then ViAir Corp. Morgan stays on the rise. Make sure you order ViAir compressors for your shop. Have them on hand when you have customers that come in. Biggity boom, you'll be ready to go. Mike, any last words, my man?
Airhead Nation, with that being said, we are
out. Yeah. Peace out, y'all.
Stay low.
Yo, yo, it's ODB. I'm back. I'm back from the future. All right, so this segment that's coming up is actually going to be a homie named Steve from 33 Pneumatics. Now, Mike and I didn't mention that earlier. We were basically trying to nail down the logistics. So we did get the audio completed, and it is an awesome interview. I would tell you guys, what we're going to do is we're going to sound off over the weekend and next week in the Airhead Nation Facebook group. You know, I want to get the perspective of the listeners, some of the do-it-yourself guys, other professionals out there in the air suspension automotive scene. Want to kind of see what you guys think. You know, there's some couple things in this interview that kind of made me open my eyes and go, hey, you know what? I never thought about that. The whole volume type thing for the air. We also talk about hard lines, which is always something that intrigues me. You know, someone like Jimmy Graham over at Jimmy's Rod and Customs, he's an amazing guy that can do some pretty badass work in terms of, I call it works of art, with the stainless steel, the aluminum, you name it. So, you know, we delve into that topic as far as the airlines, which is pretty badass. You'll hear me say it multiple times. It's a 30, T-H-I-R-T-Y, number 3, and then it's Pneumatics. So I'm pretty sure if you type in 30 and then number 3, it's going to come up for you on Instagram. Check it out. Now, this segment, I'm going to go through a little bit deeper dive into All Time Low Magazine, issue 16, winter 2018. So when the issue came initially, I did kind of hit on a few things, but I did want to do this full flip through. I also will record these flip throughs and I'll add them to our Instagram, or not Instagram, YouTube channel. That's important because go out there and subscribe. We've got a pretty small subscriber base. I think what we're going to continue to do here, you know, as we start hitting shows this season, including Forbidden Fantasy, we're going to put a lot more content out there. So original content, not just the episodes primarily, is what you're going to see. When we upload through Podbean, it also batches over to YouTube. And unless we've got some crazy copyright infringements, then those stay up there. If there's some crazy copyright deals with the music, then those are automatically deleted. But so All Time Low Magazine, issue 16 flip through. You've got Dave Schneider's truck. We've had him on. He's rocking the CC Cycle wheels. Love the truck. Upper right corner, you've got the Mazda Minis on the rise, of course. Extended cab. And then you've got the brothers in skating, from skateboards to mini trucks, in the lower right corner. The back, you got the homie, Relaxed Chris, the Isuzu. You've got a really kick-ass S10 above it, which is an international feature. And then below it, you've got Tacoma that reminds me almost of like Mike Finnegan's color type Tacoma, right? That same front end, really kick-ass mini truck. But really, when you get into it, you've got Scraping the Coast on the inside front cover. You got the table of contents, breaks down, Brothers in Skating, Blue Dini, D21 California, Relaxed Zoo, Low Blow, I Would Truck, 6,000 Miles feature, Raisin Hell, and Not Your Average S10. So you've got Airing It Out, which is by Rich Waterman, kind of a little editorial. You've got the Far East Cruise, Photos and Words by Chuck Healy. And this coverage is pretty cool. I like that there's a lot of photos, but there's also a solid write-up as well. Brothers in Skating, I mean, this is epic. Pages 8 and 9, as you heard me say earlier. Blue Dini and the D21 California, which that same truck, as Mike pointed out, is also on the Orange Beach Invasion limited edition artwork. So this feature, you know, you've got the layout of the two trucks, and then you've got Blue Dini, which is the extended cab S10, old school. Man, these trucks are so classic. I continue to see these kind of making a comeback. Love the extended cabs. It's got some nice billet wheels, darker interior, and then the D21 California, dream come true with the best of both worlds. So the convertible, both of those trucks I just mentioned are rock and relaxed atmosphere. All right. So Greg Miller and the big homie Sean, they have Bayou Showdown. So you have photos and words by Damian Davis. So another, and that was Sean Randall, by the way. Another set, you've got another couple pages here of great coverage, whether it be S10s, the Dualies, the Yukon, you name it. Lots of show coverage. Boom, then you land on Relaxed Zoo, From Inspiration to Creation. Big ups to Relaxed Chris, that's with a K. This truck, the interior, dude, super, super stoked for this guy, man. The truck is so awesome. I can't wait to see it in person. The interior is so on point, it's not even funny, man. Love the color choices, the contrast between the interior and the exterior. Solid write-up. The breakdown kind of gives you all of the info that you need. I love also the Rodeo Dash. So that's kind of an awesome mod. To me, I love that dash a lot more than the pickup or the pup dash. You flip the page, you've got the special thanks, a badass rear end shot of the truck, and then you've got the Our Lifestyle of the Podcast ad. Boom. Then it rolls into Northern Showdown, which Chris is a part of. Great coverage, everything from lowriders to dualies to minis, of course. Really cool awards. And then, boom, you're on Low Blow, a.k.a. the fucking truck. So you've got the Dino Chevy Only sticker that Dave rocks on it, on the front windshield. What a feature. I mean, this truck really was due to have a kick-ass feature. And this one really hits on all aspects of that build. There is a quote in here from Dave. It's the same old story. I was just going to drive it. Then the motor had some problems, pulled the motor, and then one thing led to another, and it totally got out of control. Salute to Dave. Good dude. All right, Orange Beach Invasion ad. You know Mike will be there. Location, the Wharf. That is spring break weekend, Alabama, Gulf Coast, March 15th to the 17th. Then, we mentioned this prior, but you got Slamfest coverage. So we'll talk a lot more about Slamfest as the year goes on. Fuel Market, you heard on episode 109, gave the nod there. They have some really badass artwork for this year. I'm looking forward to it. This is technically my 23rd straight year, I think, going to the show, if I did the math correctly. So I'm looking forward to it. You've got Roro's Isuzu there with the tilt bed. You've got Diesel Wheels. They brought in the V-Dub. You've got I Hate Phil's S10. Of course, Shulman's got Crew Cut and the Precious Metal featured there as well. Everything from David DeCorver's Dually, which was outside. I mean, such a special truck there. We've talked about it in the Street Trucks feature. You had Josh Ellis. You had Randy from Negative Camber, Orlando area. You know, he's got the famous Toyota. That's also here. You've got Big Juice with the Topper Gang. Jimmy's Rod and Customs, the homie Mike as well. Mike Hill with the Explorer. Fester from Down South RA. So many good people. You got Angie Ellis. I mean, you just look at the feature and you're like, man, I know all these trucks, right? So you kind of go through, you see the real Matt Smith, his Dually, his S10, so on and so forth. And then, oh, by the way, ODB's in there rocking the donk board. What great show coverage. You go on, you've got a couple ads, and then you've got Severed in the Midwest. So another awesome show, nice mix of vehicles. And then I would truck 6,000 miles. SEMA truck makes it to Japan. So I don't know how many people knew that. But this is the Toyota that I was talking about. I won't dare try to say the owner's name. You'll see it there. This is on page 47. 97 Toyota Tacoma. 3-inch body drop. 18-inch Ford Mustang wheels. And damn, it looks good. So kind of a, I call it a throwback mini, right? It brings me back to the early 2000s, and it's super sick. Love the ragtop, the colors, interior. It's what I call mini trucking 101, man. It's perfect. Right? Then you got Coming Soon. It talks about After Dark, Mini Truck Showdown, Lone Star Throwdown, Orange Beach Invasion, and Forbidden Fantasy. That's what's listed in print. After Hours, you got that show there, Hank Aaron Stadium. And that is July 13th, 2019, from 4 to 10. Okay, then you've got the tech section. So on the cover, it mentions introducing our new tech section, Cambered Corner, both with a K. So you've got a pretty badass one-page, simple, to the point, Cambered Creations tech article. Okay, Raisin Hell. This is one of my favorite mini trucks, a Mazda B2200. This thing is awesome. It's an 89. Super sick setup in the bed. You'll have to see the photos. Interior's all done. Damn nice truck. Then Not Your Average S10, and The Best Is Yet To Come. This S10 is got it all. Sleek exterior. Love the paint color. Nice little offset on the wheels. It's from Lookin' Club, and he's got a nice little nod to, I don't know if it's like a 60s Impala. I think it is because of the way the dash is done as well. But on the outside, the front bumper in the rear roll pan also has that kind of famous, you'll see it like on the 63 Impalas. I don't know what they call it, but it's the, almost looks like billet aluminum, that little piece on the bumper. But damn, it looks good. You got the owner in the truck. This is a 96. It has hydraulics, which is badass. 64 Impala dash, as I mentioned, and billets. You got reader rides, and then boom, off the wall. They always end it with some pretty cool photos. One of my favorite in this whole batch, not only do you have a little guy here with a mini truck and shirt, so, you know, the next generation, you got Holly in here from probably Forbidden Fantasy, looks like, but you've got a guy that is an acrophobia. I've shared his truck several times on my at C30 addict page. This is a famous, I think it's his wedding day, and he's using his wife's dress to kind of polish his wheel, so to speak. So obviously, like, you know, that's not the best thing probably to polish a wheel with, but it's cool that you know, he, you know, set that that photo up the way he did. You could follow him on Instagram. It's Aces, A-C-E-S, Wild Rides. He tags us a lot on at C30 Addict, and that truck that he has, that white dually, is insane, dude. So salute to him. But there you have it, All Time Low Magazine. If you guys haven't subscribed, you're straight slipping. Even if you can't read, it's all good. There's plenty of badass pictures. ATLmagazine.com. Make sure you get 2019 subscription. All right, so check it out. 33 Pneumatics. Enjoy this interview and get ready to sound off on the topics that we talked about. I know I'll be running this manifold on Project Smuggler's Blues. We out ya. Enjoy it.
Yeah. 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 Can't be done. Now I'ma let the champagne bottle pop. I'ma take it to the top. Show, I'ma make it hot, baby, baby.
I pop, pressure the pussy, the stunt, and I pop. Steady pump, squeezing my pistol, I'm sure that I got my Peter Piper, big peppers, and run rock rounds. I'm 50 cent, I ran a little bit.
Yo, yo, yo. So as I mentioned, I had my little intro to Steve with 33 Pneumatics, man. So, Steve, man, I met you, I'll say, on Instagram. The homie Jason from Relaxin' in St. Louis, he, you know, said, "Hey, man, you gotta look up my homie," and I did. So, what's going down, man?
Oh, not much, man. Yourself?
Hey, everything is good. So,
hey,
let me ask you this: the listeners may not know this, but you're up in Canada, right?
Yeah, we're in Vancouver. Well, sort of. We're just outside of Vancouver in British Columbia, Canada. Yeah, yeah, just. You know, the northern Mexicans up here.
That's funny. And yeah, shout out, I wanted to say, Jason, Relaxin' in the Park, St. Louis. So good dude there. I think he knew you from different circles and whatnot. But, you know, can you tell the Airhead Nation just like a little bit about who you are and then your company, 33 Pneumatics?
Yeah, sure. So, my name's Steve. I've been, I got my license when I was, I was 19 when I got my license in 99.
Okay.
And in 2002, I got my first bag truck and haven't looked back. And so we've seen the industry change throughout those years, obviously from like some really basic stuff to some pretty fancy stuff with other companies, constantly innovating and constantly changing some things around. And, we've been installing now for quite some time. And we basically found some products that we liked, but we always were changing things to make them look better or operate better. And finally it just came down to, making our own. It was time to take a step and take that lunge into as we know it, 33 Pneumatics with the introduction of the manifold valve and products we're now in development of as well. And we'll talk about those in a sec, I'm sure.
Yeah, dude, for sure. Airhead Nation, do yourself a favor. You guys are Instagram junkies like me. Go out, type in 33, so it's THIRTY, number 3, underscore, and then Pneumatics, PNEUMATICS. So, Steve, like obviously someone like yourself, you kind of established that you've been around the air suspension, give or take, kind of going on 2 decades, right? I know we're both kind of young guys, but you've been doing this a long time. And, what I wanted to kind of find out from you is, what is something that you've learned, like related to air suspension that you have found really invaluable as you've continued, doing installations and just kind of do-it-yourself stuff on the side?
Well, the biggest thing, in large part, we would do installs with friends and stuff in the early days. And as things got busier and busier, we started a company that we did installs. And so we were doing them constantly, lots and lots of installs. Again, that's what came up with the valve. And we actually found that the relationship between pressure and volume was one that's greatly overlooked in most cases. It's not talked about. It's not, it's like an unspoken rule that no one's, a lot of people, I'm not sure even understand, in its entirety. And I'm not even sure I understand its entirety, but, it's crucial when you pick your components that you pair your tank size, with your pressure, your tank pressure, via your compressors and so forth. Cause a lot of guys are running, they're running tanks that are too big, or not enough compressing power, or they're running pressures that are too small or pressures that are too high, resulting in, extended, run cycles on your compressor, or I don't even know. I'm talking myself in circles here.
No, it makes sense.
Cause
we've seen trunk setups. Like I've seen a couple really cool ones where they got 2 small tanks. Then you've seen other guys that are like, man,
yeah.
I want to have, I know one guy that comes to mind, he's like, man, I want to have a lot more air, man. I've got 2 36, maybe 48 inch tanks. And it kind of gets to the point where like, do you really need that much air depending on the size vehicle that you've got and whatnot?
Well, that's exactly the case. I'll use an example like air struts, for instance. They've been a big changer because it's kind of brought air into the limelight. Like air was always like the ugly stepchild of the automotive world for a lot of years. And the air strut has kind of brought it back into a highlight position where it's not only, popular, it's almost the norm, with shows like SEMA and a lot of their tuner shows and I think starting to creep into some of the mid-truck shows are these quote unquote tuner, vehicles. But they're using much smaller bags in a lot of cases. And you're able to use a much smaller tank to fill these bags. So, you don't need, let's say, like an RE7 in a lot of cases. You can get away with an RE6, or in some cases, an RE5 in the back of an S10 or back of a Ranger, where normally you would use a 7 or a 6, and you can cut down your you know, your tank size, and you can cut down your pressure sizes because, you know, I mean, for the most part, no vehicle needs 200 PSI when, you know, the air suspension is properly installed. Lots of vehicles need 200 PSI when the air suspension is incorrectly installed. If we can go that far, or that sort of a leap, so to speak.
Yeah, totally. I get what you're saying, and I've seen the stuff that you've done. If you go out on Instagram, as I mentioned, 33_pneumatics, you know, check out some of the photos and whatnot. You know, outside of the, like, if you take the topic that we just kind of hit upon with the different volumes and whatnot, what do you think is maybe one of the most overlooked things by installers, maybe outside of that, in the air suspension world? Like, I've got one thing that comes to mind, but I kind of wanted to see what, you know, what your thoughts were.
Overlooked by installers. That's a tough one. There's a ton of fantastic installers out there. I mean, you see it time and time again where, you know, you've got guys like Sadistic Ironworks and they're putting out gnarly stuff. And then you see a trickle down effect because I don't want to say he was the first, but he certainly was one of the first to really, commercialize the trunk install, at least from my standpoint. And what you're starting to see, you see a trickle down effect. I don't think a lot of installers are making mistakes. I think in large part, some installers are not using products correctly for aesthetics purposes. You know, you make an install look better by not running a water trap, let's say, or you make, again, same thing. It looks better without a check valve on a compressor or right. So forth, and yada, yada, yada. So it's not so much that they don't know how to do it. It's just there's, you know, when we're going after the difference in today's air ride world, really, at least the way I see it, is the difference between a winning car and a losing car at a car show has a lot to do with the air setup. You know, obviously wheel choice and stance and all that plays a crucial role. But if those two things, if the cars are identical on the exterior, say, from a point standpoint, the trunk install is going to make or break it. And so, I won't say cut corners, but a lot of things are sometimes admitted for an aesthetics purpose rather than a function purpose.
I saw a video on YouTube the other day, and I was just kind of going down the wormhole, and I was looking for, I don't know if it was tips on hard lines, but I just wanted to kind of see what, you know, if there were any kind of cool videos out there for what guys are doing. As you mentioned, I mean, these suspension setups have gotten crazy. And there was a video that was like, hey, I'm going to show you how to do hard lines. And the video was pretty short. And all the comments were like, dude, you know, your video is mistitled. Like, it really didn't show you anything. Like, there was a couple things I kind of got from it. I was like, okay, is that how they're doing this? But one of the things that was funny is he didn't have a check valve on the compressor. And I think in that video, if I remember correctly, like, he was running the hard line right to it. And, like, people were, like, nailing this guy. And, you know, I totally get it where, you know, if you've got a hard line of aluminum, or I think some of these guys are running copper, right? Over time, the vibration and stuff, like, that's just not a good thing.
This is true. You know, and you and I are going to disagree a bit here. I understand exactly what you're saying, but we run hardline direct to compressors, and we have yet to have a failure on that.
Oh, that's good to know. Okay.
Now, yeah. So, I mean, now if you're running a straight piece from point A to point B in a compression fitting, okay, the likelihood of failure is higher than if you're running a bent piece from point A to point B, obviously with check valve in line. With push to connects.
Got it.
Because if you can imagine, if you've got two or three bends in it, it's the same way if you look at your brake lines right out of your master cylinder.
Mm-hmm.
They all have loops, right?
Yep.
And that is for vibration. Okay. So the same principle somewhat applies. And then, of course, being compression fitting, some guys swear by compressions. I personally don't care for them. Some guys swear by push connects, and some people don't care for them.
Mm-hmm.
But the compression fitting holds the line very, very rigidly. Okay, so any vibration is going to be a problem. Whereas push connects, there's much more freedom within the fitting itself, allowing for some mild movement. if you understand.
Yeah, definitely. And I think, and to me, it's important for someone like yourself that's been doing it and has the hands-on. You know, that's, like, you speak from experience, and I think that's key because, you know, we see it all the time on YouTube. People get, you know, slammed for maybe the way they do something or the way they fix something. But I am of the mindset of, you know, if you do something and it works and you never have an issue with it and it's safe, then hey, then it's work for you, you know? So, you know, to me, it's good hearing that, man, because it sounds like from experience, that's worked for you guys.
Exactly. Now, I will tell you, when we first tried this, you know, we took flack because we got the same thing about, you know, vibration this and vibration that. And we were concerned, and that's why we did it on our own car first.
Got it.
To make sure, obviously, we weren't letting people run around with stuff that wasn't tested.
Right.
But our own car, like I said, it was a kind of our guinea pig car where we would test new products or test other things that to make sure that we were putting out even other competitors' products that were worth something. So, you know, if we were testing a valve or we're testing new compressors from, you know, be it Flow or ViAir, that we were able to resell these things knowing that they are good products.
Understood.
And so in our own car, we did the hard line from tank to compressor with a check valve in line and 189,000 kilometers. So that's about 120,000 miles. There was no issue as far as cracking or leakage due to vibration. So, and that's with those are with Flow and they're, I think they're a 480 compressor. So they're, I mean, they're big dogs, you know, they're going to vibrate quite a bit. So that one there, again, in my experience, push connects, we use copper, we've used aluminum. Obviously you want to put your check valve in line. We haven't seen the failures like you hear of, or the speculation of failure like you hear of online.
Got it. So let me ask you this. Kind of since we're in this realm, you know, I live in Florida. It's very humid. And like on my wife's setup, I had two water traps on it when I had her car bagged. You know, I did most of the work on it as far as laying it out, but basically had, you know, two water traps. And, you know, what's your thought process with those? Because like you mentioned, there's people that don't run them. And I would imagine some valves are going to, you know, get gummed up and the moisture is going to really impact the system overall. What I found is like when I would go to release the valve, like there'd be like a good bit of water in there, right, in that water trap, right? So what's your experience with the water traps and like seeing the guys that aren't running them?
Well, yeah, and the water traps are crucial for sure. And you're right. What we talked about earlier about the biggest thing I see installers doing incorrectly is probably water trap placement. A lot of people are under the impression that water trap goes between the compressor and the tank, and that's simply incorrect. The water trap, basically, its sole purpose is to keep debris and water out of the valve. Mm-hmm. Okay, so it needs to go between the tank and the valve. And the reason being is if you were to put the water trap between the tank and the compressor, simply the temperature change throughout the day and into the evening would create condensation in the tank. Beyond the water trap, that condensation is now going to end up in your valve. Okay, so you want to keep all the condensation. This is the reason we run aluminum tanks, whether they're flow tanks or whether they're seamless tanks or whether they're airlift tanks or whatever. Everything we put in is always aluminum. Mm-hmm. for that purpose. So we know water is going to be in the tank. Our goal is to keep it out of the valve. And that goes with all valves, you know, again, from debris to moisture, especially in Canada, you know, our winters get a little hairy. So the more we keep moisture out of the valve, the less likely it is to freeze. The less likely it is to freeze, the more you can enjoy your vehicle year round, even when it's minus 20 outside.
Yeah, I totally get it. And I've seen guys, whether it be like the old school valves or like these manifolds where they don't run a water trap. And I just always kind of thought, I was kind of brought up in the air suspension world that it's like, look, man, you know, if you have a steel tank, you're going to have rust in there. It's going to get nasty, to your point. Now we've got aluminum tanks. That's fantastic. But I'd rather keep that moisture out, because I've had various valve blocks over time where if you don't know how to take it apart, even though it could be easy for the average guy, you're going to end up having their valves sticking, things like that, where you can't air it up or whatnot. And it becomes like a real pain in the ass. So you want to kind of, what I call, bulletproof the system. You know what I mean?
Absolutely. The more fail safes you can put in your system, the less problems you're going to have. The our valve, for instance, and I don't think we're alone in this, our warranty requires you to run a water trap just so that we, there is no debris. I mean, it's even goes down, especially if we're talking about hard line and whatnot, right? Let's say you cut your hard line, you don't debris your edges, which I'm sure most people don't. I mean, I'm guilty of it myself in some cases. You go and plug it in, you don't run a filter or a water trap before your valve, and the next thing you know, you've got a sliver of aluminum holding up your valve. It's not the end of the world, but it causes your one side or another to either lift constantly or drop constantly.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's that could be easily rectified by again, a water trap.
Definitely. So, you know, speaking of the next, you know, and just products in general, can you tell the listeners about some of the, like, the current products your company offers? I know, like, you've got that one main manifold that you've been selling, and then we could talk about next some of the new stuff you've got maybe on the horizon.
Certainly, yeah. So, I mean, the only thing we're known for at this point is the 33 manifold valve, which, you know, we designed based on, you know, some of the things we were changing or the way we were altering our installs of other products. And so we created this valve, and in this valve, in the design of this valve, we decided to take it a little further and go, you know, ask ourselves as installers what we wanted to see. And what we came up with were a couple solutions. So unlike any other valve on the market, on the bottom of our valve, we've got an 1/8-inch port. And that port is designed for your tank pressure switch. So again, by putting the pressure switch in the valve versus the tank and having the valve behind the water trap, you eliminate, or I shouldn't say eliminate, you greatly reduce the chance of moisture getting into your pressure switch. Again, now that we're dealing with Canada, when moisture gets into a pressure switch, it freezes in the winter, cracks, and now that pressure switch doesn't work anymore. So we looked at that as a solution. Okay. Number two, we looked at the solenoids. We went right to GC valve to get our solenoids because it's the valves we were using before manifolds became the big thing. So we went right to the boys at GC, and they hooked us up with a rad little solenoid pack. And then simply, which it's funny because a lot of the other companies that are making the manifolds have somewhat walked away from this, and that's the gauge port. So we still have gauge ports on the back of ours. So if you're the guys that are running gauges, you know, you don't have to run T-fittings on your lines to get your gauge readings. Now, T-fittings, obviously, you have to hide them because they're unattractive. B, there are three potential leak zones in every T-fitting.
Mm-hmm.
And so by putting in the valve, you eliminate that. And then the next thing we did was the threaded ports. Simply put, you know, we've used the other companies that have the push connects, which are great. However, on the odd chance that you happen to nick an O-ring or you've got failure of the that fitting, now you're sending that product back to the manufacturer to have it fixed or serviced or replaced. Ours, you can choose whatever fitting you want. If you want to run stainless hardline, you can put, you know, swedge locks fittings into our valve. You want to run copper, you can put PTCs. You want to run compressions, you can put compressions. If any one of those fittings fail for any reason, it's a simple roadside repair with
change it out.
Products that are widely available. Exactly. So that was a big thing for us, was making it so our products are serviceable, because as we get further and further in the innovation of air ride, products are becoming less and less serviceable.
Correct.
More and more they're becoming, you know, something of a problem within themselves. Yep. If you understand what I'm
like
saying.
Like an alien form. Yeah, exactly.
Right. So we wanted to make sure that we were true to ourselves and we were true to the consumer when, you know, if you've got a problem on the side of the road and it is, you know, a fitting or it is a 30-second fix, we don't want that 30-second fix to be a 4-hour fix because something we've designed incorrectly.
Yeah. And I love it, man. And, you know, speaking, you know, having spoken to you on Instagram prior and, you know, a little bit, like one of the things that got me is when my buddy Jimmy Graham at Jimmy's Rod and Customs, when he installed the AccuWear setup on my 67 Lincoln, like there was this one thing, like he's very, when he does the hard lines, he likes things to be symmetrical and stuff, right? And he's really good at bending the hard lines. So what got me was, you know, Jimmy's like, you know, I kind of really hate how they did this one thing. And I, you know, you and I both know this with that manufacturer, at least on the VU4, I know they have a newer product. It's like the 1, 2, 3, and 4 ports, like the way, you know, the one I think goes to the driver's side, and then you've got the 2, which is the front passenger.
Yeah, the 2 and 3 have to cross one another.
Yeah, they got to cross over. So unless you repin the unit, which, you know, I guess if you, you know, which is what we basically did, you end up having these lines cross over. And for the average guy, like it may be no big deal if, you know, if you're not displaying your stuff, but like little things like that. And then also, like, to me, I love getting in a vehicle that has air ride that even still has the gauges, whether it's a single dual needle gauge. My homie right now is running old school manual valves on his 65 Lincoln, mostly quarter inch lines, you know, just kind of a basic setup. But like, I almost like that setup. But it's like, okay, if I want to go to an electric setup, I could get something like what you have. And you've thought about some of these other key things that, with the gauge piece, the ports, so you don't have the push to connect. And then the last thing I'll say is this. No joke, on my wife's car, I had the VU4, and I had the challenge where the, I forget what they're called, the, are they called cartridge fittings or something, where they're pressed into the block?
Yes.
And if you don't have I think it's called NPT, right? In those valve blocks weren't as widely, you know, used or sold. You basically, I was like, what the hell's leaking? I finally figured it out. Take it out, mail it back, and then what they do is they have to repress in the whole fitting. So to your point, the serviceability becomes a little bit more tough, you know?
Absolutely, absolutely. So yeah, I'll touch base again on what you said about the lines crossing over, because I didn't. On our valve, we've designed it. So in all theory, you know, the Acura one is 1, 2, 3, 4, for instance. Ours is 1, 3, 4, 2, which means out of the valve, the 2 left hand side go to the left, the 2 right hand side go to the right. So you never have crossing over lines.
Yeah, something basic like that to me is just awesome, bro.
Exactly. And in most cases, I mean, you know, we've installed before where, you know, we've done it so it goes into the floorboard like a false floor and they cross over under the false floor. Mm-hmm. But on a truck install, for instance, on mine, for instance, it's naked. When you lift the, you know, the bed, the valve is there and it goes right to the rear bags and there's no room for crossover. You can't fake that. Mm-hmm. And so that's where it came to our attention too, because ourselves as well, prior, we had to repin the competition valve also to get it to work correctly, or to get to work to our
liking,
installation standard, I suppose. Yes.
Yeah, there you go. Well, we'll talk about the new product, maybe some hints you can give us in a moment, but I did want to let everyone know, when you go to 33 Pneumatics on Instagram, and you'll see one of the posts where he has the dealer display, and it's pretty cool. You can zoom in there. That's what I'm looking at now. I also like that it's the billet aluminum, right? So you got that nice, classy look overall. You got the 2-year no BS warranty, so it says it straight right there. The other thing that I thought was interesting was, now this is also set up so that you can use the leading manufacturer controllers, right? So you might have somebody that still wants to use a special controller. And as you know, as you are well aware, Steve, like these valves, oftentimes, like, you know, if you're a wiring expert, you can wire them and you can, you know, it's pretty easy. But tell us, how easy is it for someone to take, like, if they've got their old school, like, hydraulic type switches or whatever they have, they can wire this bad boy in, right?
Yeah, exactly. So it's quite simple. Every wire that comes out of the base of our valve, and our wires do, they actually go through the valve and out the bottom. So when you install our valve, it appears wireless. You see no wires, you see no pressure switches, you see nothing of that sort, because it's all on the bottom. Now, they're all color-coded, so it makes it easy if you're wiring, obviously, basic switches, you know, all over, you know, you're not dealing with all black wires. The left is purple, the right front is green, et cetera, et cetera. Furthermore, if you happen to be using one of the leading competitors, management systems, I think probably the industry leader, our valve is color-coded to their system. So green to green, purple to purple, you know, orange to orange, yada, yada. So that makes it extremely, extremely easy and user-friendly. And we wanted to do it that way because we understand that, you know, there are people looking for options. They're looking for, you know, they like product A, but they want to pair it with product B and C. And so we don't want to limit them to have to run all of our stuff or make it difficult for them to run different things that they want to do. We want to make our product fit universally with everybody else's.
Yeah, seamless. And I definitely see that. So, I mean, I think, like, we pointed out multiple reasons on why you would want this valve block, so to speak. I know on my 64 Lincoln, I'm going to be doing some work. And, you know, I looked at it. I believe it even comes with a mount. I think you had a post recently where you said, you know, don't forget to look in the bottom of the box. Remember to look down there. You get the free 10G mounting plate. So to me, like, I've seen some pretty sick setups. And if I click on the icon to the right on Instagram, it'll show me all of the photos that you've been tagged in. Or you can check the hashtags. You will see some pretty slick setups. And I tell you what, that valve block looks damn good in whether it's hard lines, nylon, you name it, it looks badass.
Yeah, we appreciate that. Yeah, again, it was an installation of one of our first valves that we designed. We realized it was kind of a pain in the ass to install with all the holes in the bottom, the four holes. You had to, you know, jump a gauge plunge in and whack it, and you'd maybe get it right. And so we ended up getting a bunch of laser cut 10 gauge for our own shop use. And we just decided, you know, if we can use these, I'm sure everybody can use these. And so they just became part of our kit.
Yeah.
And that's what we like to do. Without increasing costs, we like to make ours so it's simple. There's no, you don't get and go, oh man, I wish I had this, or, you know, I wish they had a template for this or that, et cetera, et cetera. We just give you the piece simply. You can choose to weld it. You can choose to use it as a template, whatever works for you. Right. So,
yeah, it's badass, brother.
That's basically, yeah, as simple as that. So
make sure you click the link in their bio in Instagram. Go to the website, scroll down on the first main page you land on. You can enter your email address there to subscribe. I did want to ask about some of the new products. So you've had some what I call teaser photos out there, sneak peek, if you will, at some of the newest addition to that 33 lineup. You kind of had a question, any guesses as to what this is? You know, you see the kind of the end square, nice, badass, looks like, you know, some pretty slick aluminum there. You know, do you mind sharing some details about that?
Certainly, yeah. We released some more photos, if you go a couple images up. It's called the 33 Air Reservoir. Now, again, it's basically an air tank, but it's a little different in the fact that it actually has in and out ports. So it has, on each side of the end cap, it has two in ports, 1/4 inch, 1/3/8, and then a single 1/4 inch out port. And you might be asking why in and out ports in a tank, and it's quite simple. We mentioned earlier about check valves, and how they're crucial to, you know, obviously your compressor, your compressor life requires a check valve. Otherwise your compressor will fail prematurely. We've put that check valve inside the tank. So it's aesthetically pleasing, as we touched on earlier, and it eliminates roughly, if you put the check valve in line, three possible leak zones. Okay. So if you're running two compressors, that's six possible leak zones. And we've eliminated those because the check valve is in the tank. On the outports, we've done the same thing. We've put the check valve and we've put a water filter. So not only is your, basically the reason for a check valve on the outport is so that if you lose tank pressure for whatever reason, your airbags stay inflated. Okay. So that's crucial because right now on, I'm going to say an educated guess, 99.9% of the valves out in the market, if you lose pressure, I think airlift's the only exception. If you lose tank pressure, you lose bag pressure. So we've eliminated that problem by putting a check valve in the tank. Therefore, you won't lose tank or you won't lose bag pressure if you lose tank pressure. Additionally, we've added a filter in the tank as well. Now your tank acts as a water trap. So again, you have three potential less leak zones than if you use a standard water trap. Again, if you're running two lines to your valve, if you're running a tank to your valve, that's going to get another six. So potentially 12 potential leak zones we've eliminated and put them in the tank.
Got it. And explain the whole water trap piece, right? So you touched upon it earlier, but what you just said is kind of like mind-blowing, right? So how does that help the end user or the person that's driving the damn car every day?
Well, quite simply, it's one less thing you, right out of the gate, one less thing you have to remember to purchase, because a lot of times you're purchasing online when you're buying your kits nowadays, right? Mm-hmm. Well, I guess all the days everything was purchased online. A lot of shops you can go to and buy stuff. So it's one less thing you have to order. It's one less thing you have to remember. It's one less thing you have to install. It creates a more aesthetically pleasing hard line from tank to valve, and has potentially three to six less leak zones than if you were to install the water trap.
And then where does the moisture
end up? And
then
furthermore, the moisture ends up in the tank, so the tank itself becomes the water trap.
Got it. And then you could just basically over time, now correct me if I'm wrong, do you have a port in there to release that the water?
Yeah, absolutely. On the back of the end cap, there is also a pressure switch port. So if you're not running our valve and you want to run our tank, you're able to run your pressure switch out of the back side of it. And then again, on the bottom, there's an 1/8-inch port. You can put a Schrader valve in, you can do whatever you want to. That'll be your drain port so that you can drain your tank as you would a normal tank. It's just ours would probably have more water in it because it's also acting as the water trap, so to speak.
Yeah. So great point. How often would you suggest, whether you live in Canada, maybe in the US somewhere, I'm damn here in Florida, man, the humidity's crazy. How often would you say the average guy or lady needs to release the port as far as the pressure, or not the pressure, but the water?
Yeah, that's a really tough question, and that's even one that I have a hard time answering myself. Even in the same environment, same compressor, same tank, we have variety of different cars. Who some come in like, you know, once a week and they've got a ton of moisture in their system, and others come in, you know, they come in once a month and they've got almost none in their system. Mm-hmm. So I have yet to figure out what's the difference between that, you know, a system that constantly fills with air or sorry, water, and one that doesn't, given the relatively similar circumstances. Obviously if you live in a drier climate, like, you know, central USA or central Canada, your likelihood of needing to empty that is fairly slim because it's a dry climate. Air.
Yep.
If you live on the coastlines, like, you know, the West Coast, or in your case, the East Coast, you're going to want to check it at least more often. Now, keeping in mind that water in the tank isn't terrible.
Correct.
It's not detrimental. It won't hurt anything, assuming you're running an aluminum tank. The minute you're running a steel one, then it becomes a bigger problem fairly quickly. But all you're basically losing is air storage. So if your tank's half full and you have a 4-gallon tank, now you have a 2-gallon tank, right?
Got it.
So it's those kind of things to be weary of. So like I said, you just want to check it. I would probably check it, get in the habit of checking it once a month, And if you find that it's got constantly got a lot of water in it, increase that to once every 2 weeks or, you know, so on and so forth.
Yeah, good tips there. So I think you made it clear, obviously, you know, the differences between the manifolds with the 33 manifold and others on the market. Obviously, I think you've made it kind of clear, too, that you guys are big fans of hard lines. I did want to talk a little bit about that. When you are doing a setup or doing an installation, I've used a couple of times aluminum. I buy these coils on Speedway Motors, the cheapest I can find it. I think it's like 30 foot for a really reasonable price, but it's coiled up. You know, there's some different tools on the market to straighten that out if you really want to go, you know, get crazy and whatnot. But what do you prefer or do you use most often? Is it stainless, aluminum, copper? What's your choice? And then do you have any tips for bending the hard lines and doing these intricate setups?
You know, for the amount of times we do hardline, which is quite often, you think I'd have a lot more to say on this topic. But truth be told, if I'm using aluminum, and I've used aluminum quite a lot, I use Moroso brand fuel line. Funny story is, and this is, it's funny that you brought up the Speedway stuff. I bought the same spec, quote unquote, from Jags as the Moroso, and it was, I won't say junk, but it was junk in comparison to the Moroso stuff. It was just soft. It bent vastly too easy for my liking. It felt cheap. I saved a buck or two, obviously, but it didn't have the same, even though it said it had the same wall thickness, either the material itself is different. Even though you would think it was the same wall thickness, when you have the two in your hands, you'll find out really quickly that the Moroso brand is a much thicker aluminum stock or different quality at the very least. As far as copper, we've used that pretty extensively. I prefer it over the aluminum, and that's purely just because of it's readily available at any, you know, not Home Depot. You've got to go to a plumbing store because, again, when you buy the Home Depot plumbing stuff, when you bend it, you actually get crinkles on the inside of your bend. Mm-hmm. At least we do it in the Canadian Home Depots. I mean, we've gone to Home Depots and Ronas and all that stuff to see who had the better stuff, but it's all the same junk.
I see.
So we went to a plumbing supply house, you know, where a contractor would go to buy it, and flawless results. So
nice.
We've powder coated it, we've polished it, we've cleared it, we've done all sorts of stuff with it. And and it's refrigeration grade. So capable of, you know, some ridiculous, you know, 1500 PSI or something stupid. You know, so.
Yeah, that's pretty sick. And I did want to hit on one more topic related to hard lines. When I see these intricate bends and things like that, like let's say, you know, you've got a valve and it's going to come straight out and it's only got a couple inches before it's going to bend down and go under. Like how much, you know, some of the videos I've seen on YouTube, how much like preparation goes into like, are guys like, it looks like basically, okay, the few times I've tried it, I'm in the trunk and I'm getting pissed off and I got my bender and I'm like, fucking these things. But it seems like they're real professionals, right? And correct me if I'm wrong, because I could be wrong. Are you building these setups like outside the car, like on a bench, like where you've got your little box where you've built it and that type of thing and you're bending it and you're in more of a controlled environment versus like stuffed in a trunk?
Yeah. So I would say probably 8 out of 10 times if you can do it, especially on the air strut type cars, you know, you build a false floor out of we use lightweight MDF. And you construct it on the bench itself and you have some freedom. There are occasions where you do have to get dirty and bend in the car and you're in and out of this stupid thing and it sucks. But you would think that this would be, at least in my case, and I can't speak for anybody, but in my case, I basically mock up where I want my compressors, where I want my tank, where I want my valve. I mount my valve where I want it. And in some cases, my valve floats. And you can probably see some of the photos. I simply know where I want it to go and I bend the lines accordingly. No plan, no idea prior. I bend them when I'm at that stage, not before. I don't even think about what I want the end result to look like. I just kind of
straight freestyle.
And once I bend, once I bend one line, that one line dictates the style of the other lines. For instance, if there's a 45 in that line, all the lines will have a 45. If there's a 180 in that line, all the lines will have a 180. Right? So you use it for the beginning of your design process, if you will. So, and that's why if you try before and you go, well, that just doesn't look necessarily as clean as I wanted it to. If you were to try it again and go, okay, I'm going to bend one line and, you know, whatever happens in that line, I'm going to continue that same theme into the following lines, you'll find you have a consistent appearance.
Got it. And I've seen that, right, with some of the work. It looks good.
Yeah. So the benefit, especially for, I would say, the guy who wants to try this out, the benefit of copper and aluminum, it's so forgivable. If you're out an eighth of an inch, you can fake it, if you know what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
If you're out with an eighth of an inch of stainless steel, you are out an eighth
Forget
of an
about
inch.
Forget about it. Yeah, I've seen exactly. Jimmy at Jimmy's Rod and Customs. Like, you know, he'll do a lot of, like, the fuel lines, the brake lines, all that stuff. And then I've seen him do some pretty trick setups with all the stainless coming out of, like, you know, one of the other competitor type valve setups, right? And it is like, yeah. I mean, you could tell, like, the bender, I think you have to have, like, you got to have a bigger bender. Like,
yeah, you need, exactly. You need some more leverage behind it for sure. Yeah. Cause stainless is, it's a tough cookie for sure. And again, stainless, some people are having success with stainless and push connects, by grooving where it goes into the push connect. So the teeth have something to grip to, but typically stainless steel and push connects don't play well together, like oil and water.
Got it.
It's just the stainless is too hard of a material for the push connect teeth to grip into.
Okay, totally got it. So before I ask you, you know, where do you see air suspension in the next 5 or 10 years? I do want to ask you about your product that you sell today. I see some pretty trick photos out there of the billet look. You know, I call it the raw. Then you've got some of the anodized, the black specifically is what I've seen. I've seen a couple, yep. I think, red and whatnot. If someone hits you up and they're like, yo, man, I'm building my car and it's going to be red or it's going to be this, how much flexibility do you have in different colors, or do you just run a few different colors?
So it's quite simple. So every once in a while, like we've ran a pre-order on red once for a Canada Day valve. We'll likely do another color here real shortly, but it'll be a single color. Now, if you're building something and you need the tank, for instance, we did a purple one. We used flow tanks on this install, and we did a purple one. We had flow send up their end caps, and we anodized their end caps with our valve. Because if you anodize purple in California, and then we anodize purple in BC, two different colors. So basically, if you don't need the valve in a hurry, and by a hurry, I mean, if you've got about 4 weeks, we can custom do, I won't say any anodized colors, but a large majority of anodized colors. It's additional cost. It's an $86 Canadian charge, and that's literally our cost to anodize the valve. So the more you can do, the less that costs. For instance, if you're going to do a tank, send us your tank too. And we'll do it all, because then it's still $86 to do all of it, if you understand what I'm saying.
Nice. Okay.
We have a flexibility. It just boils down to timelines. In some cases, like for instance, right now, we've got all of our stock is anodized, ready to be assembled and shipped. So we don't have any raw blanks, which means we can't anodize a custom color right this minute. But the next run, for instance, we normally keep about 10% of our stock as raw for guys who want to polish it or guys who do want to do custom color. And that if we have a raw stock, then, yeah, like I said, it's 2 weeks to anodize and a week to assemble and a week to get it to you. So if it's 4 weeks time from the time of order, we can usually get you a custom color.
Yeah, very cool. And scrolling back on your Instagram all the way to the beginning, you know, January 22nd, 2017, you mentioned that you were introducing the product. So it's been out there a couple years, folks. And, you know, I'd highly suggest if you're looking for an economical type valve manifold, you want to go a little different, definitely what I'm going to run on Project Smuggler's Blues. I'm looking forward to it. something different, something that looks fantastic, and it's got the function as well as the overall look. So I'm super stoked about it. Let me ask you this. I hinted a moment ago, where do you see air suspension just overall, the entire scene in the next 5 to 10 years, man?
That's a super tough question, because I wouldn't see it where it is now 10 years ago.
That's a good point.
You know, I think that for in large part, I think we will start to see, I'm hoping, someone do something with a compressor. You know, not saying that the companies that exist today aren't good. It's they have literally been the same damn thing for, well, you know, 2 decades without much in the way of change. You know, so I think we'll see somebody do something with a compressor. I think the innovation that a lot of the companies are putting out, a lot of the North American companies are putting out, will continue. You might see some dips. You know, some products might crash and burn. Some might take off. But I think the innovation will continue. I don't think we're going to see a lot of change in air. I think, you know, I'm going to kick myself in the ass because, you know, the minute I say this, it's going to change. But I think for the most part, you know, air is what it is. And again, you're going to see innovation upon that, you know, refining the way things move or work or operate. Aesthetically, we're going to see an increase in how eye-catching products are, you know, because they're going to operate the same, but they're going to be much more pleasing to the eye. If you go back 10 years, air suspension, it was very, very industrial. Mm-hmm. You know, you had 8 valves. It was wires everywhere. It was unglamorous, so to speak. Mm-hmm. You know, now you go, if you fast forward 10 years, you know, we've got billet valves, for instance. We've got beautiful controllers from AccuWare. We've got rad controllers from, you know, Sound Specialties with their LEDs that change, you know, multitudes of colors. You know, Flow's billet compressors, for instance, Flow tanks, where, you know, they're very, very nice pieces. I think that's where we're going to start to see more and more of is the innovation upon. I mean, yes, some of the mechanics will change, I'm sure, but for the most part, I think we're going to continue down the aesthetics road.
Yeah, I couldn't agree more. I do think, like, and this could be a pipe dream, or it could just be me not knowing enough about it, but we've seen the likes of, like, AccuWare over the course of time. Like, to me, they do have actual innovation. Like, they come out with something pretty cool. I, you know, thoroughly believe in the CVT. I also, like you hinted on earlier, I like something that's a little less complex, because I've been in situations where, you know, the car's down several days to overnight something to California to get it back, you know, those type of situations. So I want something, you know, that's going to be good form, good function. But at the same time, I've seen people that have, like, begged for the, keep me honest here, the pressure systems, right? So you've got AccuWare that's on the levelers they're often referred to as, right? Then you've got some of the other brands.
Yeah, the height bait systems.
Yeah, the height bait systems. And then you've got other brands that I was just reading about them where, like, I guess it, like, fills the bags all the way up, and then it lets out so much air, and it kind of knows. And, like, I just wonder, from, like, an AccuWare 2.0, so to speak, like, do we start seeing Bluetooth this and, you know, less wires and stuff?
Well, I can tell you, without too much hesitation, that we've got something coming up that's it's going to be pretty rad. It is a Bluetooth controller. It's a physical controller. It's not off your phone or anything of that matter.
Uh-huh.
And basically, it wires. So when you wire our valve, you will only wire power and ground, mm-hmm. and the controller will control our valve.
Pretty sick.
So, and then we're going to be. I shouldn't say we're going to be. We are looking at options of incorporating a pressure-based control system. Right out of the gate, it will have a gauge of 5 pressure readout. Mm-hmm. And then in the future, we will have the control of pressure in bags and such, and obviously in your tank. Our end goal is something very similar, like a height-based system, because we are believers as well that a height-based is a superior way of monitoring than a pressure-based. But that doesn't mean that there isn't a place for pressure.
Got it.
What a lot of the companies, and again, I'm going to put my foot in my mouth here, a lot of the companies have failed to do is offer good products that do exactly what they're supposed to do, but at reasonable pricing. And that's not to say that, that the other guys are overpriced. It's just you either get, you know, pardon my French, shit, or you get fantastic product with all the features. There's nothing that is great product with a little less features for half the price. Yep. Do you understand what I'm saying?
I do.
So there's an entire market there, and I think there's a lot of client base who sit in that market. And we're going to be offering a system that will somewhat cater to that, where, you know, it's not, you know, a basic switch box and some gauges. It's a, you know, a fairly, you know, basic switch box, Bluetooth, mind you. Again, all billet, all of our stuff will always be billet. And then pair that with, again, the pressure monitoring system. By pressure monitoring, I mean pressure, not just readouts, but pressure acquiring. So it can acquire and maintain a pressure in a given egg.
Nice, okay? Dude.
So, yeah, I probably said more than I should have here, but now you know all the dirt. So that's what we're working on first and foremost. And we're hoping to have that somewhat ready within the next year. And then we're working towards a much larger, more, you know, all the bells and whistles, you know, will be incorporated into the system beyond that. But that's for another time.
No doubt we'll have you back. But Airhead Nation, you heard it first, man. Big stuff. You know, lots of different opinions in air suspension. You know, we've had Max Fish on, you know, the suspension guru. We've had lots of different people, lots of different companies, and it's kind of cool to hear from someone else's perspective. You know, I would tell everybody, you know, listen, take it with a grain of salt. If you've got your own opinions or if there's things that you're like, no, that doesn't work, you know, at the end of the day, if things work for you and it's safe, then, you know, do it. I totally agree. Because that's what I do. Shit works for me. I make it work. So it's been a pleasure having you on. Before we wrap up, I did want to ask you, man, the 33 in your name, it does seem like a little bit of a nod. You're from Canada. You're about the same age. I mean, you had to have watched the Rad movie growing up, right, man?
Yeah, funny you say that. The 33 in 33 Pneumatic certainly plays homage to, you know, the greatest BMX rider ever, Mr. Crew Jones at Cochrane, Alberta, for sure.
Hells yeah. And you got another spin of the family with the Crew Jones, man. Did you want to share that with the listeners?
Yeah, it's funny. So that movie, I mean, I was a BMX rider, but I raced motocross, so I was a little removed, but it was the only movie that really put racing in on the big screen at the time. And even though it was a very small big screen at the time, it was still the big screen.
Yep.
No, my little guy, his name's Crew. So, it certainly is a movie that has stuck with me throughout the years.
Yeah. Hell yeah, dude. Well, that's badass, man. And you know, it's great putting a voice to, the name 33 Pneumatics. You know, Steve is a good guy. I would tell everyone, if you want to get a hold of Steve, click the link in their Instagram bio. If not, you're going to be left spelling out 33, THIRTY, number 3, and then pneumatics.com. Of course, you could Google that and hit that page. But, Steve, correct me if I'm wrong, people want to get a hold of you all different ways. They can DM you, hit you up by probably phone or email is probably easiest.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, if you want to if you can get a hold of me on Instagram, I run the Instagram page, so you'd be talking with me. If you want to talk on the phone, I'll gladly shoot you my number. Email works, info@33pneumatics.com. Any way you want, you know, we can make that happen.
Hells to the yeah. Well, go out there, Airhead Nation. If you're kind of on the fence about what you're going to do with the next build, start a list, write down 33 Pneumatics, know that you're going to run a great product, good solid warranty, and you got someone like Steve that's working behind the scene to bring badass products out to not just the United States, but the whole damn world. So, Steve, we wish you the best of luck, my man. And we might be hearing from you here again soon, man. We're going to try to get a little giveaway going, so we'll see what we can do for the Airhead Nation.
Certainly, yeah. Once we get that tank rocking and rolling, we'll have to certainly give one away.
You got it, my man. Well, we appreciate you. Keep doing what you do, and I just want to say we out you.
Tell niggas get their money right, because I got mine. When I'm around, quit playing, nigga, you can't shine. Woo! You going to be that next chump, then up in the trunk after being hit by the pump. Is that what you want? Be easy, nigga. I lay your ass out. Believe me, nigga. That's what I'm about, gangster. You can find a nigga sitting on throne. Hit the clutch, hit the gear, hit the gas, and I'm gone.
Yeah. If I can't do it, homie, it can't be done. Now I'ma let the champagne bottle pop. I'ma take it to the top. Show, I'ma make it hot, baby, baby.
I'm down for the action. He's smart with his mouth to smack. Woo! You hold your strap, you might come back, so yeah. Clap. React like a gangster, die like a gangster for acting. Cause you be hitting homicide and be asking what happened. Oh, no. Look who prepping with the 4-4. 20-inch rim sitting on low, bro. East side, west side, you can know, yo. Even my mama saying something really wrong with my brain. Niggas don't rob me, they know I'm down and down with my chain. G-Unit,
yeah.
We get it poppin' in the hood, G-Unit,
yeah.
Motherfucker, what's good? I'm waiting on niggas to act like they don't know how to act. I had to sip it to my jack, I blow them off the map with the Mac. Thinking it's all rap, till that ass get clapped. And Doc says
it's a rap, nigga.
If I can't do it, homie, it can't be done. I'ma let the champagne bottle pop. I'ma take it to the top. Show, I'ma make it hot, baby, baby.
I ain't been how to teach lessons to slow learners. Go ahead, act up, get smacked in the head with the burner. I don't fight fair, I'm dirty, dirty. I'm from Southside Jamaica, Queens, nigga, you heard me.
Yeah.
When the street lights come on, niggas blasting eyes. Get locked up, then read books to pass the time.
Woo!
And the game is ups and downs, so I stay on their grind. Niggas on my dick more than my bitch, I stay on their mind. There ain't nothing they can do to stop my shine. This is God's plan, homie. This ain't mine. I play the music loud, so grandpa called me a nuisance. And grandma always gotta throw her 2 cents. I'm the dropout, I made more money than his teachers. Ruthless like the coupe, but I come with more features. I am what I am, you can like it or love it. It feels good to put 50 grand and think nothing of it.
Fuck
if I can't do it, homie, it can't be done. Now I'ma let the champagne bottle pop. I'ma take it to the top. Show, I'ma make it hot, baby, baby. If I can't do it, homie, it can't be done. Now I'ma let the champagne bottle pop. I'ma take it to the top. Show, I'ma make it hot, baby, baby.
I'ma make it hot. Dr. Dre, Aftermath, Shady,